realms of inward journey. I have been speaking on various realms through which an individual travels. This is somewhat like Al-Ghazali's valleys, seven valleys. Nanak speaks of four realms of inward journey. The first he refers as dharma. Dharma does not mean your religion. The English translation of dharma as religion is inappropriate and does not include all that it means. Dharma means the essential nature, or the essential nature, just as the essential nature of salt is saltishness. So saltishness is the religion of salt. So too, bliss is the essential nature of each individual. Your religion is bliss. How to attain to this blissfulness? And once that comes in, everything else falls into the right perspective. But we do not consider this as our religion. So first is dharma. Khand. Khand means section or realm. This refers to essential nature. The second comes gyan or knowledge. It refers to the awareness of your essential nature. First comes essential nature. What is the essential nature of salt? Is saltishness. Then in knowledge, or the gyan refers to, is salt aware of its saltishness? Are you aware of your essential nature, that bliss is my essential nature? Bliss is the texture of which I am composed of. This is the second realm. And when you are aware of that which is, you are aware that you have attained to a certain light within, you will hesitate in speech. You will be aware moment to moment. For instance, when someone asks, are you enlightened? There is awareness that enlightenment is. Everything is incandescent in that. But there is hesitation in saying that I am enlightened. If I say I am enlightened, that I am holding on to I. What is enlightened? Who is enlightened? Instead of that, you are aware, and when you are aware of that which is, you know everything is incandescent in that light. You will hesitate in saying. You cannot deny and you cannot respond. This is the state or realm of ignominy or modesty. Implies being modest or helpless or empty within, realizing your situation. Instead of saying I am enlightened, it would be better to say that enlightenment surrounds everything. Everything is incandescent in its light. And then when all these three things happen, grace begins to descend. Every moment there is grace, you live in a totally a different kind of realm. You are a citizen of the ivory tower of your own creation. These are the four stages of the journey. And journey for what? What are these realms necessary? And where are we heading towards? The destination is truth. The destination is truth. In order to attain to truth, that which is, these are the four realms through which you have to journey. Formless dwells in the realm of truth. He creates and then watches all that has been thus created. The journey ends here. The painter makes a painting. He moves away from the painting, changes the distance and watches the painting, watches it from the left, from the right, Just as a photographer, when he is taking a photograph, he takes from different angle and he looks at the camera lens to see how does this image looks, makes a certain adjustments and goes on taking. When you start overflowing with the grace, nothing is left of your own. You search for your identity, but you will find nothing. All around you will find him. It is said, once a fish asked a Sufi, where is the ocean? And this fish was a Sufi fish. So in a way, she was the master among the fishes. So the other fish inquired, where is the ocean? The fish inquired, ocean is above you, below you, to the left, to the right. You live in ocean, you breathe ocean, you drink ocean. It surrounds you. There is nowhere else to go. In the same way, all around you will find him. In the realm of grace, you are simply an instrument, a flute-like, hollow inside. And as soon as the music starts playing, it simply echoes. Beyond this, you are not even an instrument. There is no one to say or even to say anything, or even you are. If you say you are, this means you are still trying to save yourself. If you are not, then words will disappear. Only silence will remain. What will happen? Just be in the company and feel the presence. If in my company or in the company of an awakened one, something begins to happen to you, you are listening to me during this period, if time becomes stagnant or time stops, that means this presence has created a state of meditation to happen to you. If the words transcend you to the realm of silence, that means the commune is happening, a communion is happening. This is the realm of truth. This is the abode of the formless. Having created, he nourishes the entire creation, inclusive of the realms or realms, planetary regions, the cosmos and everything. There are numerous orbits, regions and firmament. There is no end to all this. There is harmony all around in cosmos. That is why it is said, cosmos, not chaos. This happens because of the existential law that everything happens in its own way. Nobody is there doing anything. The seasons are running in their own way unless the ignorance of the man destroys the very texture. Then things begin to happen haphazard. This is beyond all finite description. One thing Nanak emphasizes again and again, he says, after creating the creation, God is not separate from his creation. In fact, it is better to say, creator is the process of creation. Creator and creation are one. The creator is embedded in his creation. If you are familiar with the writing style or the music or whatsoever the artist is, if you are familiar with his techniques, his hands or his impressions, you will see everything. Whether he writes something or composes something or creates a music or creates a painting, you will be able to identify because his hands are, his invisible hands are there in that particular creation. And this process of creation does not come to an end. Once started the process of creating, it goes on. In fact, God is the process of creation. Creation is His joy or celebration. It's not that He created something and He stopped. Every day flower blossoms. Every day you come across a new rainbow of the birds. Each flower blossoms every day in a different way. So the process does not end. Once the process of enlightenment has happened, that continues. Every day, more and more new realms are open. You would have heard much talks about attachment as the way to attain. Detachment is considered as one of the important aspects that you have to detach yourself from this and that. But detachment is a technical word. You are attached to it. I am talking to you. I am attached to this particular talk. But the moment the talk is finished, there is a detachment. Attachment and detachment are two sides of the same coin. It depends on from whichever side you are looking at. It is difficult for a man to understand whether this is head or tail. Somewhere in an unknown region, coin is one. It has two sides, head and tail. You can face the head or you can face the tail. For the purpose of game, you can choose the head or tail. But deep within, the two merge into one another, to disappear into an unknown realm. And when you reach from each side, you start journeying from the head side, the other starts reaching from the tail side. You may pass through the tunnel of head and the other will pass the tunnel of tail, and when you meet together, there will be no head, no tail, just emptiness. So things are like these. What appears to you to be attachment is detachment. This is difficult for you to understand. Nanak says God is creating, and in the process of creation there is an involvement, because you are creating. I am speaking, I am involved in this particular talk, because the words have to be formed, the message has to be given, the silence, the spaces have to be created, the gaps have to be created to create an entire, to create a particular milieu in which meditation can happen to you. However, this involvement or association is not blind like you. In your involvement, there is possessiveness. And your possessiveness makes you miserable. All you are involved or associated with your wife or husband, and you want to possess. This possessiveness continues with everything and every being around you. In His association, this possessiveness is not. God creates you and then gives you total freedom. God creates you then gives you total freedom. This freedom allows you to deviate from His path, commit sins, move towards the evil path. This does not imply that He pushes you towards the evil path. He loves you. This is the reason He does not interfere with your freedom. By allowing you the freedom, He brings maturity and trust in this process. You are free. This does not mean He has turned His face from you. This is difficult for you to understand. Try to understand this with an example. A mother loves her son. She does not give any freedom to her child. Out of love, she takes all freedom. He wants to manipulate the life. This is out of attachment. Love is not attachment. Love gives you freedom. If love cannot give you the freedom, it is no more love. You are afraid of losing. This is the reason you create so many bondages, so many restrictions. In the process, you not only destroy love, but also the capacity to love. This is the reason that you go on failing in love. And not only you fail, instead everyone fails as well. Without freedom, you cannot learn to walk on your own. Love is like walking on your own feet with freedom. This is attachment and love. Out of attachment is only blind, is not only blind, instead dangerous as well. Out of your ignorance, you think all this is necessary for protection. This is what happens around you. The relationships between husband and wives are examples of possessiveness. God's ways are unique. A mother's love is attachment. However, his attachment is out of awakening. His attachment protects you, but he does not destroy your freedom. His security is your freedom. However, these are the two opposite things. He stops you so that you can be worthy. He supports you so that you can one day stand on your own. On the other hand, there is a mother. You cannot explain this to her. And if you somehow explain this, then she moves to the other extreme and she becomes now detached. She gives freedom for doing anything. She leaves you to do all that you want to do. This is one type of freedom. This is called freedom for. This is dangerous. God gives you freedom, but his freedom is freedom from. One is freedom for. The mother gives you the freedom for to do anything that you would like to do. But God gives you freedom. And this is freedom from. This is freedom with awareness. When there is freedom with awareness, it is freedom from. First, the mother loves you blindly and then she ignores you. And the balance is in between. This balance is the nature of God. His eyes are fixed at the creation. He protects you so that you can be free. He gives you freedom so that one day surrender may be possible. He allows you to go astray. If you are not allowed to go astray, how can you come near? Yet still he protects you. He allows you wherever you go. Like a shadow, his energy field surrounds you so that one day you can take an about turn. You are going astray. His energy field holds you, but he does not stop you. Instead, allows you to go astray. Yet still he does not pull you towards him with his energy field. He waits and hopes that one day it will happen. And when you return, he rejoices. To explain and understand this is very difficult. You will recall the story of a rich man. He has two children. The elder one was very loyal to the father and he was always helping the father in his business. The young one wanted the property or the resources of the father to be divided. He took his share, wasted it in merrymaking and other things. The other one was always there. One day the news came, the younger son wasted all the money and the wealth and he is now returning empty-handed. The father make a great grand feast for the younger one. This made the elder one very surprised. He was all around supporting the father in his ventures, but father never arranged for a feast for him, but he made for the younger one. So at this he complained to the father. Father said, "You were always with me." And this one went astray and he comes back, he returns. It is necessary to have a great grand celebration of feast because he is returning. He rejoices, and to explain this is very difficult. Certainly there alone all opposites rest, all contradictions disappear. In fact, enlightenment is that realm where all contradictions, all conflicts, all opposites merge into one another. Where there is no heat, no cold, no right, no wrong, no good, no bad, no day and night. All contradictions dissolve into one another. There is no head, no tail. That is the realm of awakening, the realm of enlightenment. It is human nature to either give total freedom for anything or create bondages and restrict freedom. This is what is happening in the West. To say anything about God is impossible. He is totality. And totality means where all the opposites merge into one another. In a way that if I have to say that enlightenment is totality, He gives you total freedom and His love does not diminish even with all this freedom. He liberates you. Love gives you total freedom or liberation. Such is the nature of His love. Nanak continues. He worries about you. He thinks about you. And when flower starts blossoming in your life, He rejoices. He is not indifferent. His indifference in deeper sense is His involvement. He is both far and near. He leaves you to explore freedom and its nature, just freedom. Even in your freedom, He has not left you. Your pain and sorrow hurts Him. And in your happiness, in your anand, He rejoices. You are not a stranger in this world. God is with you. There can be no greater assurance than this for a devotee. Whatever you do in this world, no one bothers. You are alive or not, who really bothers? The world considers you a mere coincidence. For a devotee or the one who knows, this is the greatest assurance. This is not coincidence. When someone returns, God rejoices. And until you return, He waits. And for your return, He celebrates. There is a deep connection between you and the existence. He is the confluence of love and freedom. Awakening is the confluence of love and freedom. Enlightenment is the confluence of love and freedom. His love surpasses all your doings. For you, love and freedom are separate. And more so, these are contradictory. How can this be possible to comprehend? He is the ultimate confluence of opposites, attachment and detachment, rag and involvement, rag or involvement and virag or detachment. This is the beauty that which is. He is the confluence of the opposites. A coin is the confluence of head and tail, where head and tail merge into one another. This is a coin. When this has been attained, you have reached to the realm of confluence, where opposites merge into one another. There is nothing else to say. There is nothing else remain to say beyond this. Each word that Nanak has spoken is soaked with the understanding. These are not the ordinary words. You can get literal or the philosophical meaning. You can give many interpretations. However, the mystical meaning is difficult from your level of understanding, from your level of consciousness. Nanak is one with God. Nanak is enlightened. He is illiterate in the sense he does not have university degrees. His ways and means is simple. To speak on Japji, the message of Nanak, requires inner preparation or awakening. Only an enlightened one can live Nanak or speak on the message contained in Japji. Nanak continues in the subsequent sutras.